Hello! Today, we continue our conversation about the expedition of Anatoly Fomenko and Gleb Nasovsky to Jerash, which they extensively described in their new book, Phony Jerusalem. Today, we have Gleb Nasovsky with us. Hello, Gleb Vladimirovich.
Hello, it's very nice to be here.
Gleb Vladimirovich, your joint scientific expedition with Anatoly Fomenko to Jerash took place after your acquaintance with the Russian Chronicle, a unique historical document that includes descriptions of the pilgrimage to Jerusalem in the 16th century. Please tell us how the description of Jerusalem in the Russian Chronicle corresponds to what you saw in Jerash.
Yes, indeed, a very good question. I am holding in my hands a copy of the Russian Chronicle. It was discovered a few years ago in a private library. It was published by the Uktown Publishing House. I will open it and show you a page from this edition. Approximately half of this volume is dedicated to the World Chronicle. And somewhere in the middle, the chronicle related to Russia begins, describing Russian history in great detail. Interestingly, many pages of this chronicle are devoted to events that are completely forgotten and absent in the version of Russian history that we are accustomed to. This invaluable source was written in 1649, and fortunately, we found it. By the way, later we discovered that several copies of it are stored in some closed repositories, studied by historians, but it has never been published by the specialists who were supposed to publish it earlier. So, in this chronicle, there is a section dedicated to the journey to Jerusalem during the reign of Ivan the Terrible. This journey is described in great detail. The Russian cities are mentioned through which the route from Moscow passed, how they set out to sea, how they sailed, how they arrived in Jaffa, and there the path split. The author speaks of two possible routes. One route goes overland through Damascus, but they did not take that route. The second route went through Jaffa. Jaffa is the modern city of Tel Aviv. It was called Jaffa back then, and the chronicle mentions the name Jaffa. Therefore, the pilgrims arrived in Jaffa, disembarked, and then continued eastward toward Jerusalem as a caravan. There was a certain town called Rama on the way. The journey is described in quite some detail, but how many days did they travel from Jaffa to Rama? First, they went to Rama, and then from Rama to Jerusalem. Now I will share my screen. Here, it is marked. This is a modern map, so it says Tel Aviv instead of Jaffa, although it is written as Jaffa at the bottom, as you can see, in English. Tel Aviv is the same as Jaffa. They disembarked from ships in Jaffa. Then they gathered their belongings, rode on donkeys, and headed east. How many days? In the chronicle, it says, day, but this expression, day, caught our attention. It looked somewhat unusual in this chronicle because in all other places where it mentioned one day of travel, it explicitly stated that it was one day. But here, it simply said, day. This caught our attention. At first, we didn't pay much attention, but it was still something peculiar. It left the impression that it might be one day, or it might be several days. It seemed like there might be a missing number here. We took note of this and continued reading. So, it was described how the pilgrims walked either one day or several days to the east to a certain town called Rama. Then, from this town of Rama, they proceeded to Jerusalem, passing through rocky mountains, and it was specified how much time it took them to pass through these rocky mountains before arriving in Jerusalem. We looked at the map, and we asked ourselves where exactly to the east of Jaffa there was a town called Rama, which was about a day's journey away. 5 kilometers and one day of travel, they needed to walk between these rocky mountains to reach a certain Jerusalem. In reality, to the east of Tel Aviv, there is only one major city, and Rama is described as a major city. If we do not consider various villages, this city is the only one, which is today known as Amman. As we can see, it is written here in Arabic with an Ain. The first letter is an Arabic, Ain, which sometimes, when translated into Russian, becomes a Buri, R. Therefore, this Arabic name can be transliterated into Russian as either Amman or Raman. The first R should be pronounced Buri, and then it becomes Raman. We knew examples where the Arabic Ain can become R in pronunciation. In the name Amman, the Arabic ending An is often omitted, which is why this city can sound like Amma or Rama. This immediately caught our attention, especially since it was the only major city to the east of Jaffa, and the name fit perfectly with Rama. Then, we continued to read in the Russian Chronicler the detailed description of how the pilgrims walked from Rama to Jerusalem. And this route was described unequivocally. We mapped out this route, and what did we come across? We came across a city called Jerash. Again, Jerash or Jerasa is Jerusalem. Yeras and Giras and Jerash. J is sometimes pronounced as Ya. These are issues of Arabic pronunciation. There are pronunciations with sounds J and with Ya. G can also be pronounced as Gay, as they do in Egypt. It can be pronounced as Ya. So, Jerash also could be Yaras and J as S. Yaras aligns perfectly with the name of Jerusalem. This incredible coincidence strongly attracted our attention. We packed off and specifically went to these places to see with our own eyes what was there. I want to tell you about what we saw there. I will show various maps in our photographs. This is the route from Rama Amman to Jerash Jerusalem. It indeed passes through rocky mountains. Here on the map, it is shown in more detail how to go from Rama to Jerusalem. Everything is measured in both steps and hours, and it precisely matches what the chronicle describes. Let's take a close look at this map. It shows what the pilgrim actually described and what European explorers found when they ventured into these areas in the 19th century, trying to find Jerusalem based on similar descriptions. They also read that the pilgrims disembarked in Jaffa and then continued eastward. And in fact, those who were searching for Jerusalem had to travel the same way. They had to first reach Rama, which is also Amman, and then proceed northeast to Jerash. What did they do? In the 19th century, when they were searching for it, Jerash was covered by a mudflow and buried under a 4-meter layer of soil. There wasn't much sticking out there, and they did not find it. So, they stopped too early. They covered only about one-third of the distance and turned in that direction. They found some mountains, passed through them, and found the village of Al-Quds. They believed it was the best match for the descriptions. Of course, they did not find any Rama, and they later named some Arab village Rama. They interpreted the name Al-Quds as holy in Arabic. They renamed it to Jerusalem and said, well, it fits. Jerusalem is a holy city. Al-Quds means holy, so this must be Jerusalem. They also allegedly found here the other names mentioned in the sources. In other words, they simply renamed Arab villages to match the required names, and traces of their search efforts are visible. They ended up with two Ramas. One is called Ramla, and there is another one here. So, they indeed searched and tried to map everything. They just didn't go far enough. They needed to go approximately 2 to 3 times farther. In the 20th century, Jerash was excavated. It is still not fully excavated. And here is a panorama from one of the high points. When we visited there, we understood the oddity that had always caught our attention in pilgrimage descriptions of Jerusalem. The strange thing is that famous places like David's house, the prison of Christ, Golgotha, the place where John the Baptist was imprisoned, and many Old and New Testament sites, all of them were at distances of tens, or at most hundreds of steps from each other. It seemed like the pilgrim was walking on a patch of land and saw all the Old and New Testament sanctuaries there. This could not have been possible, of course, but that's how it was written, and it always amazed us. And here, we understood what was going on. It turns out that the pilgrims didn't travel to the real Jerusalem. From the very beginning, this Jerusalem was for show. More precisely, it was an ancient Roman sanctuary from the time of the Royal Christianity, according to the new chronology, which was destroyed by the Ottomans when they conquered these areas in the early 16th century. Shortly after that, they converted one of these ruined Roman sanctuaries into a fake Jerusalem. At that time, the Ottomans were still Christians, and they came up with the idea of creating such an exhibition. Essentially, they created religious tourism. Instead of taking people to places that were hundreds of kilometers apart, which was difficult, especially given the means of transportation at the time, they created a place where there were replicas of all Old and New Testament sanctuaries on a patch of land. They fenced off this area and brought pilgrims from around the world there for money. By doing this, they strengthened religious feelings, and it had to be strengthened in those days because it was shortly after the failed end of the world, which everyone had been promised in 1492, also known as the 7000th year from Adam. It didn't happen, and there was a significant upheaval in people's minds. Faith in the church and those in power, who said one thing but another happened, was significantly shaken. Therefore, there was an ideological necessity to support people's faith. There may have been other considerations, but this brilliant idea, ahead of its time, to create international tourism, especially religious tourism, came to the minds of the imperial authorities, primarily those in Istanbul because they controlled these areas at the time, and to create there a prop version of Jerusalem. The Turks were there, collecting money, as is written in all the pilgrim accounts. Thus, once again, this city was an old Roman sanctuary adapted for an imitation of Jerusalem. This is an overview of what has been excavated. On the left, I'm pointing with my mouse. These hills have not yet been excavated. There were some structures there as well, but they are all buried under the mudflow. There was an earthquake, and underground water came out from the mountain, bringing streams of mud and stones that covered the city. On the right, all of this was excavated in the 20th century.
We will continue our conversation with Gleb Nasovsky about the expedition to Jerash next Sunday, December 20th. See you in a week.